So I'd like to talk about these notions, energy, momentum, and center of mass. So this is center of mass in general relativity, not to be confused with center of mass in algebraic geometry, as appeared yesterday. So let's start with Einstein's theory, just a little review. So it stipulates that the space-time is a four-dimensional Lorentz manifold that satisfies his equation. So we're given a four-manifold. I write it as N3-1. With the Lorentz metric. And you recall, this means the signature is minus, plus, plus, plus. And we're going to assume the vacuum case, and therefore the Einstein equation is just going to be this Ricci flat condition. So this is the so-called vacuum Einstein equation. This is a case when there's no matter field and everything's just purely gravitational or purely geometrical. Okay, so this is actually an equation of the Lorentz metric. And let's see how we formulate this, this problem. And there's this initial value formulation. Of the equation. Of course, a trivial solution of this equation is the Minkowski space-time. So the space-time is the R3-1, and this is a familiar one. I'll use this plane here to represent R3. You have a time coordinate here. So this is a time coordinate. And this t equals 0 slice actually corresponds to a copy of R3. Of course, the Lorentz metric is just the diagonal one. Okay. But in general, how do you formulate this, this equation? So the idea is that we consider space-time formulated by time function. So space-time foliated by time slices. So again, you have some initial slice. So this t equals 0. You can look at an induced metric. So this is the induced metric. And you can consider the development of space-time. And therefore, at a later instant, you get another time slice with induced metric GT. So these are metric on this hypersurface or three-dimensional Riemannian manifold. And it turns out this the vacuum Einstein equation can be written down as an evolution equation of this GT here. So roughly speaking, it satisfies the following equation. You look at the second derivative of the metric on each time slice. And that's approximately the Laplacian of GT. Okay, so this is the evolution formulation of the Einstein equation. And as you can see, this is actually a second order hyperbolic system. Well, in fact, it's much more complicated than this one. In particular, it's actually very nonlinear. But nevertheless, this is a second-order equation. And you know that for second-order equation, you need to prescribe the initial value. And also, the first derivative. And this is roughly the second fundamental form. Well, in fact, if you choose a good gauge, this is exactly the second fundamental form of this time slice. And as induced metric and second fundamental form of a hypersurface, it satisfies this, let's just call this three manifold M, GK. So actually, I satisfy a compatibility condition. Of hypersurfaces. And the equations are where this is the scalar curvature of the metric, and there are actually four equations here. This, K here is a symmetric two tensor. But altogether, these are called vacuum constraint equation. Okay. And with an equation like this, you would like to know what kind of boundary condition you would like to impose on the equation. So what is the boundary condition? And then this time, we call focus on isolated systems, so boundary condition. Consider isolated system. So you consider the gravitational field near a star, a planet, or a black hole. That is actually far away from other celestial bodies. And mathematically, it means that when you go out to infinity, the induced metric and the induced second fundamental form should be very close to this t equals zero slice in the Minkowski space. So let's give a definition here. So we say a initial data set, so MGK here, is asymptotic flat. If there exists a compact subset, such that the complement of this compact set is diffeomorphic to a union of n's. So this is a union. So each one of them is diffeomorphic to the complement of a ball in R3. And through this diffeomorphism, this Hn acquire coordinate system, so let xi here be coordinates on n. So the picture is the following. We assume that the manifold is asymptotic flat. So you go out to infinity, it's very close to R3, and there's some topology inside. So this is your compact set here, K. But then outside this compass set here, we assume there's actually a coordinate system outside. So there's some xi here. Okay. With this coordinate system, you can actually compare the induced metric with a flat metric. And you require that this g here, or gij, is equal to the delta ij. This is a flat metric on R3, plus big O of minus 1. And the second fundamental form should decay to 0 according to Lewis decay rate. Where R here is just the coordinate radius. So this will correspond to R equal to a constant. And also some suitable decay. For derivatives. Of G and K. And throughout this lecture, I'm going to assume that this MGK is actually asymptotic flat and satisfy the vacuum constraint equation. This is asymptotic flat here, and this is the vacuum constraint equation. And this is a very nice condition in terms of this evolution problem. Now you can show that if an initial time, this asymptotic flat plus vacuum constraint is satisfied, then so is any subsequent time. Or this condition here is actually preserved by the Einstein equation. So you can take an asymptotic flat and satisfy vacuum constraint equation and let it evolve by the Einstein equation. And all the subsequent slides will satisfy asymptotic flat and vacuum constraint equation. Okay. And now our question is, so what is the mass of the system? And there is this canonical definition, so-called ideal mass. So let me review this definition. So first you have an energy component, and it's defined by the following expression. Okay, where this SR, they are coordinate spheres. So assume each N is diffeomorphic to a complement of R3. So you can look at those surfaces defined by R equal constant. So this is an SR here. These are coordinate spheres. And then this new I here is just our uninormal. Of these coordinate spheres. And these are just ordinary derivatives. And it's also the momentum component. Okay, so this is a definition of the ADM energy momentum. And now here comes the well-known positive mass theory. It's proved by Shen and Yao. And later, Wheaton give a different proof. So you observe that, well, suppose you have an initial data set here that is asymptotic flat and satisfy the vacuum constraint equation. Then this E here, the energy is always non-negative. And in fact, E squared minus summation I goes from 1 to 3 of pi squared. This is always non-negative. And therefore, you can take a square root of that expression. And this is called the ideal mass. And there's also a rigidity statement in this theorem. It says that if m is equal to 0, if and only if this data here actually come from the Minkowski space. So it is actually a hypersurface in Minkowski space. Okay. So that is very nice. Once we know the mass of the system, our next question is, suggested in the title. What is the center of mass? Well, usually, center of mass is related to the definition of mass. But when you come back and you look at this expression here, you wonder how come these mass expressions are so different. And in fact, if you just recall the Newtonian gravity case, okay. So in this case, the equation is actually much simpler. It's just a Poisson equation on R3. So Laplace phi is equal to 4 pi rho, where rho here is just the mass density. And you learned in calculus that the total mass of a, let's say you have a bounded domain here, omega, a three-dimensional domain in R3, it's just the integral of this omega. And the center of mass, integral, it's just the integral of coordinate functions against the density. So this is what happened in Newtonian gravity. But somehow here we have a very different expression for the mass and energy momentum. And why is that? Generally, this is Einstein's equivalence principle. It says that there's no density for gravitation. Well, in mathematical terms, it simply means that at any point, you can actually choose a coordinate system so that the derivative of the matrix all vanish at this point. Okay? And therefore, this naive formula that the total mass is equal to the integral of mass density is simply not true in general relativity. Okay. So what are the existing definition of center of mass? So let me first review this definition. And you know you have to use something very different from the Newtonian case. Basic two types of definition. Well, the first type of definition was actually first proposed by Huskin and Yao. Okay. Well, in this case, they consider a Riemannian manifold that is asymptotic flat in the following sense, that is symmetric, is equal to 1 plus m divided by 2r plus big O of r to the minus 2. And in general, this M here is exactly the ideal mass of this initial data set. Assume that M is positive. And in this case, they show that there actually exists a unique CMC foliation. Sigma R at R equal infinity. Well, you know, in R2, you have all these coordinate spheres that are constant mean curvature. So for an asymptotic flat manifold here, you're hoping to find a canonical foliation. It turns out it's a CMC, constant mean curvature condition is actually a good condition. And you can find a unique foliation if this mass is positive. Somehow this mass is used to anchor the center of mass. And then we define the center of mass to be equal to the limit when r goes to infinity of the average of the asymptotic flat coordinate on these CMC surfaces. Okay. So this is the first type of definition. A lot of following work on this this definition. But for the benefit of time, I'll just skip those. And there are actually different a different type of definition that are proposed by physicists, so-called recitable definition. Okay. And in this case, we define the central mass integral to be the following expression. So this uses a coordinate sphere. Three of them, so this is CK, is equal to this. Okay, and you can see that this expression here is closely related to the IDM definition of energy. In fact, you can see if you just consider this one here as sort of energy density here, and the first term here is just the integral of coordinate functions against this energy density. There are actually very important gluing constructions. Of initial data set was prescribed by central mass integral by Covino and Shen, and also Lanshen Huang. And each definition has its advantage and its problems. Okay. I mean, of course, this is a very nice geometric foliation, and this one here is closely connected with the ADM energy momentum. But let me just talk about some of the problems. Well, first of all, there's actually this issue of finiteness. Well, you can see that we're integrating this energy density of one, against this coordinate function. But this coordinate function is actually of the order of r. And this in general is of the order of r to the minus 2. And the area grows like the order of r. So this integral apparently diverges. You need to assume some parity condition in order to ensure the finiteness. And there's another problem that is you have this central mass here, but what is the physical meaning of this? Well, you compute this integral, you get three numbers here, okay? And it doesn't really correspond to a point on your manifold. What does that mean? In particular, what is the relation to the dynamics of the Einstein equation? In this regard, let me just mention another definition of Cristullo. Okay, so here you assume that the initial data is strongly asymptotic flat. In the following sense, so G is equal to 1 plus n over 2r. Plus b out of r to the minus 2 minus epsilon, and k is equal to big O of r to the minus 2 minus epsilon, where epsilon is positive. So the decay rate is slightly faster than the asymptotic flat case. And this condition actually implies the ADM momentum. Vanishes. Pi is equal to 0. So you can see the Pi is defined in terms of this Kij. So if decay too fast, it just vanishes. In this case, Cristullo actually give a definition. There exists a definition of center of mass that is conserved by the Einstein equation. And in today's talk, I want to introduce a new definition of a center of mass in general relativity. So this is new definition, as I mentioned, this is done with Pauline Chen and Yao. Okay, so therefore for each asymptotic flat initial data set, we associate a center of mass, Ci, and in fact, we also define angular momentum, JR here, such that, well, first of all, we can prove some finiteness theorem without parity condition. So let's use very strongly the vacuum constraint equation. And secondly, we can show that how you actually change under the Einstein equation. So if we consider this m, g of t, k of t here, to be a family of initial data set that satisfy the vacuum Einstein equation. Okay? And for each initial data set, we can compute its center of mass and compute its angular momentum, and presumably depend on the t. And we can prove the following formula. Where this is the ADM momentum, or linear momentum, that I just erased. And this is the ADM energy. And this is the derivative of the center of mass. And we should interpret this one here as a relativistic version of p equal mv. Okay, this is a familiar formula from classical mechanics. And as far as we know, this is the first time definition of center of mass and other conserved quantities that satisfy this this formula here. And in fact, the angular momentum is conserved along the Einstein equation. So in the rest of my talk, try to introduce this this new definition. It's actually rather complicated. It involves a lot of tools in differential geometry. As I mentioned, this is a scenario where only geometry counts. But to motivate our definition, let's first take a look at the special relativity. So let's look at conserved quantities. In a special relativity. Now the theory of general relativity is unified theory of special relativity and Newtonian gravity. Okay, and there is actually very well-defined notion of conserved quantity in special relativity. So in this case, the space-time is just a flat space-time, so it's just a Minkowski space-time. So there's no gravitation, but there are matter fields. But to each matter field, so you may consider an electromagnetic vector field, matter field. There is an energy momentum tensor. Of tensor of matter density. Okay, so this is T here. So it's again a symmetric two tensor. And according to Noether's principle, so each continuous symmetry of a physical theory gives a conserved quantity. And the isometry group of Minkowski space is 10 dimension, and therefore they correspond a 10 dimensional Keating field. And each one of them corresponds to a conserved quantity. So again, in this case, you look at a three-dimensional domain. So this is omega 3 here. And you look at the unit normal. And you take any Keating field, then you just integrate on your omega of t of ku. And this this energy momentum tensor satisfies this conservation law. And a Keating field satisfies the Keating equation. And now we imply this is actually a conserved quantity. And the 10-dimensional conserved quantities are, well, if you just use a standard coordinates in Minkowski space, you have t here, and x1, x2, x3 here, then the translating Keating vector field in time direction, this will give you the energy component. And the translation in space direction, that will give you the linear momentum. And if you look at this rotation Keating field, a corresponding one is angular momentum. And lastly, there are also this boost Keating vector field. Okay, so these are boost Keating field. So this corresponds to a rotation in space and time direction. This will give you the center of mass. But now this is exactly our problem. Well, as we know, in GR, well, first of all, there's no density, as we just mentioned. And also, for general space-time, there's just no symmetry. Okay. And here's the ideal. So this ideal that has been around for quite at least half a century. For example, Penrose actually mentioned this in one of his papers in 1982. That is, well, we notice there's no density, so there's no hope to express the mass or conserved quantity as an integral over the domain that we're interested in. But somehow, if you come back and you look at the Newtonian case, you see that this equation here tell you that you can actually do integration by parts. So this part here is actually boundary integral instead of a bulk integral. And likewise, this easy exercise here, just use the fact that the coordinate functions are harmonic. you can write down the center of mass integral here as a boundary integral. So although the naive formula doesn't work, but somehow maybe we can write it as a boundary integral. So this is the idea of quasi-local mass. So the idea is to define conserved quantities quasi-locally as the integral over the boundary of your of the domain, which is a two-dimensional surface. Okay, so this is actually the problem of quasi local mass. And so you first define this one on a two surface. And then for asymptotic flight, so MGK here, and recall in this case, when you go out to infinity, there are all these coordinate spheres. So what we can do is we can actually define these conserved quantities on the coordinate spheres, and then take a limit. Hopefully, this will give you the total conserved quantity of this system here. So here's the plan. Now we just focus on a two-dimensional surface in our space-time. So in particular, this is a higher codimension situation. So codimension is equal to 2. I want to find a best match. Of sigma in R31. So this is our reference space time. I mean, whenever we're looking for when we're looking for ground state of this problem, I mean, we should ask, what if there's no gravitation? If there's no gravitation, then this is a Minkowski space time. So we're going to find the best match of sigma in R3 as a reference surface. Sigma tilde. So this is your physical surface. And you want to find a reference surface. And at the very least, we hope that these two are isometric. So we can actually anchor the intrinsic geometry and look at how the extrinsic geometry or how the ambient metric affect the geometry of this surface. And then through this identification, we pull back the symmetry in Minkowski space. So there's actually an identification of these two surfaces through this isometry. And then whenever you look at a Keating field here, you can transplant this one back to your physical surface. So now let me go into detail on how we implement these ideas. So the idea actually goes back to joint work with Yao about 5 years ago. we call this the optimal isometric embedding. So we're going to introduce PDEs in order to log this this best match. Okay. So let's start with this two-dimensional surface in a space-time we're interested in. Okay, and we're going to extract geometric data from this surface. And but first of all, we're going to get the induced metric. So let's assume this is space-like. So this is a Riemannian metric on a two-dimensional surface. And in fact, we're always going to assume this is topological. That's two. Okay. And well, on this surface here, there's also this mean curvature vector field. So this is the normal vector field that is defined by the first variation of area. And since we're in a co-dimension two situation, this is actually a genuine vector field instead of a scalar function. And we're going to assume that this H here is space-like. And therefore, we can extract the norm of H, which is positive by the space-like condition. And actually, and another important geometric data, we call it R bar H. So this H here is a section of the normal bundle, and it's nowhere vanishing, and therefore we can use this one here to define a connection one-form. Okay? So this is what we call a connection one-form. Of the normal bundle. And in a mean curvature gauge. Okay. And what we're going to do is we're going to take this data here. So assume you have a surface here. Now this is a surface, and you have a metric, and you have a function, a positive function, and you have a one form here. And you notice that this, in this case, well, we are actually in Lorentz case. So the structure group of a normal boundary is actually SO11, which means the connection one form is a genuine one form. Okay, it doesn't carry any the algebra structure. So this is a genuine one form here. So from these geometric data here, we're going to determine a optimal isometric embedding. Yeah, so I mean, this idea actually really goes back to Weil. So Weil has this isometric embedding problem, was solved by Nirenberg and Prokhorov. For example, you can think about the R3 case. Suppose you have, in R3 you have a surface here, and how do you know the position or the embedding of the surface? And what I do is they solve this isometric embedding problem. Namely, whenever you're given me the induced metric. And if the Gauss curvature is positive, and we can uniquely solve the isometric, and solve the embedding. And I'll tell you the position of the surface, of course, up to the rigid motion. In our case, well, if you take a surface, in Minkowski space, and you extract this data here, and the procedure will actually recover the embedding. And this is for a surface in Minkowski space. But now you can apply the same procedure to a general surface, so a physical surface in a physical space-time. You extract this data here, and you solve this equation, and you declare that this surface that you get is the best match. So let me write down these equations. So as I said, so we look for a surface here in Minkowski space. So let's assume it's given by this embedding. As I mentioned, we require that this is an isometric embedding. So isometric embedding. Of sigma. Okay, so we satisfy this equation, dx dx is equal to sigma. But as you can see, this actually, this does not determine the embedding. This is very different from the three-dimensional case. Well, here your space is four-dimension, so you have actually four unknowns correspond to the four coordinate function. But for a metric, on a two-dimensional space, while you're learning undergraduate geometry, there are actually only three equations. So you have three equations plus four unknowns. And therefore, this is an underdetermined system. And so we're going to impose this optimal condition. By a variational method. I'm going to write down a functional, call it a quasi-local energy functional. For each isometric embedding. And then we're going to minimize this energy among isometric embeddings. Okay, and to define, to write down this equation, I have to introduce some notations, okay? So let's suppose we have an isoembedding here, okay? Well, the metric is already the same as the original metric. And then, well, here we can look at this x of sigma here. Okay. On the surface here, so this is a surface in the Minkowski space. And again, we have the mean curvature vector. And it's still assumed space-like. And therefore, we can extract the norm and the connection 1-4. And well, we're going to impose conditions on this on the coordinate. So let's let tau here be the time component. Of this x here. So if you just fix an R3 here. This is a time direction. Then this height here is actually the time component. So this is just a function on your three-dimensional space. And then we define a function, rho, and a one form, j, on sigma. So where this rho here is defined by this expression. And this j here is a one form on the surface. So it's defined the following way. It's rho d tau minus d hyperbolic hyperbolic sine, inverse hyperbolic sine. So this tau is just a function, so we take a d, this is a one form, likewise it's d one form, and these are both one form, okay? And then we define this quasi-local energy. For an isometric embedding. to this. Yeah, by the way, this is actually a Laplacian, and this is a gradient. So this Laplacian and this gradient here, they're actually with respect to the induced metric. Notice that there's only one metric in the whole scenario. Okay, so for any isometric embedding, we'll just define these two quantities, geometric quantity on the surface, and then we define this quasi-local energy here. Well, this is gradient tau. You recall tau is the time component of the isometric embedding. So this expression is actually, go back to basically, so it's actually coming from the Hamilton-Jacobi analysis of the Hilbert-Einstein functional. So it was previously considered, derived by Hawking, by Brown-York and Hawking Horowitz. But anyway, so this notation here is quite complicated, but this is the energy we have. And as I mentioned, what we're going to do is we're going to minimize this energy among isometric embeddings. So we're going to minimize energy. Among isometric embeddings. Now you might expect that, well, since these expressions are so complicated, the Euler-Lagrange equation is probably going to be even more complicated. But it turns out, so the Euler-Lagrange equation is simply the divergence of J with respect to the induced metric is equal to zero. And for each critical point, so correspond to an isometric embedding, and when this equation is satisfied, and you can come back and look at this expression here, and you see that you can actually do integration by parts, and the second term vanishes. In this case, this E of sigma x is just equal to 1 over 8 pi over sigma rho. And we call this the quasi-local mass of this critical point. And this is the quasi-local mass density, this function rho here. In particular, we prove some, this equation is actually very, although I write it in this way here, looks quite simple, but it's actually very complicated. In fact, this is actually a fourth order elliptic equation for tau here, okay? But just to relate to differential geometry, if you just look at a surface here that is in R3 and look at the linearization, then it's actually this equation. So you remember we're looking for coordinate functions. Turn out this is actually the equation, the linearization of this equation. As I said, this is a fourth order equation here. And if you're familiar with a surface theory in R3, in fact, this is just the uninormal. And when you actually have a surface that is of constant mean curvature, it will just reduce to this equation, which is same as the harmonic map equation into a sphere. Okay. Okay, and we some prove some properties of this this quasi-local mass. So, for example, we prove positivity and rigidity properties. So, we can prove positivity of this, assuming some convexity condition. More importantly, we prove the following. Well, suppose this density is positive. So, if a critical point, well, now we're going to call a critical point an optimal isometric embedding. Has positive density here, then we can show that it is locally minimizing and locally unique. Okay. And you see, well, before, our problem is that we don't have density and there's no symmetry. But now, yes? Huh? Do I have, still have 10 minutes? No? Okay, yeah. Okay, let me finish this quickly. But now we have this rho and j here, okay? So these can serve as surface density. And we also have a surface that is in the Minkowski space. And that can be used to pull back symmetry. And therefore, we just define our conserved quantities with respect to any Keating field in R3 in the following way. And when K is a rotational Keating field, you get angular momentum. When K is a boost vector field, you get a center of mass. And then you can actually apply this one here to an initial data set here. Okay. And the theorem that I just mentioned here actually tells you that if the ADM mass is positive on this initial data set, then there exists a unique minimizing optimal isometric embedding of the coordinate spheres that approach to a center configuration. So that theorem here actually gives us this uniqueness theorem when the ADM mass is positive. And this is how all these conserved quantities are defined. I'm sorry for going over time. I think I'll stop there. Thank you. Thank you.
I wish I could write so clearly on the blackboard.
Yeah, well, I guess I teach enough at Columbia. So.
In a ruling's definition,